2015, everybody. It's time for the last match of day number one. We have 3 days throughout this entire tournament. For anybody just tuning in, we're going to hop directly into the TheFishou versus DTwo. Now, this matchup is pretty cool. It's got a pair of people who put pretty far in BlizzCon. The TheFishou stopped in the round of 16 for Europe, but DTwo went almost all the way to the grand finals. He stopped in the top four. So that was really awesome accomplishment for both these guys. We're joined by Faramir from Trig, the teammate of DTwo. He's currently down 0-1 because we're hopping in mid-series with the Heat. So how do you feel about DTwo's chances in the series overall, even though he's down 0-1?
I don't really know the decks that TheFishou plays, but I'm pretty confident with the lineup that we picked for this tournament. So I'm sure that he can come in.
Did you help him pick, or is it kind of independent thoughts? Because I know you guys are in different time zones, but you also are a player who stays up for NA times. But a Powder at the same time is going to school, and he's also in Europe. So how do you guys work together as a team at the moment?
Yeah, we like prepared together, like the three of us, but we ended up picking like slightly different decks. Everyone like, some have Patron, some have Control Warrior, like some have like one deck different because we prefer it. But other than that, we like prepared together pretty much for the same thing.
How do you feel about this matchup overall with Lothar, with DTwo versus TheFishou?
Oh, I meant, you mean between the players? Not between
Yeah.
Yeah, well, both are experienced players, that's first of all. So I think nerves are here not making any difference for them, because they're both well televised before, they're both known names in the pro scene. So I guess it's they're both like, you know, on the same level when it comes to skill-wise. And I think this will be a really interesting match. The one thing that makes a difference here for DTwo is the fact that he's already 0-1 and he had a lot of time to think about the match because it was interrupted at some point and they did wait for the broadcast to happen, right? So this might kind of affect both of the players actually, right?
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because I really look at the TheFishou's lineup and even though we do hop into it midway, we don't actually see what Warlock it is. Although the TheFishou, the one thing that sticks out to me is that he didn't bring Warrior at all to this tournament. In fact, he brought Druid instead of that Warrior slot. What do you think about that, Faramir?
Well, in the preparation for this tournament, like we recognize, like just in the recent tournaments, like the Gfinity qualifier and like the NVIDIA tournament, that a lot of people were trying to counter Patron Warrior. So some people decided to just not bring it, to not be weak to that line of play. So TheFishou seems to be one of those. Brings Druid, which is like always a risky pick because it can backfire if you don't draw correctly.
Yeah, the blowback can be real with that.
I mean, Druid is a class that has high blowback. The hero power makes you take a lot of damage.
Yeah, even without weapons. Well, he basically has a weapon. Yeah.
I'm always really interested to see how the TheFishou builds his Hunter decks because he is known to be more of a generally aggressive player, but the web spinner already makes it seem like it's going to be a mid-range type deck.
Yeah. That's true. And maybe he's using, let's say, Snake Trap, but in overall in the current metagame, Snake Trap might be really bad when you think about
it. What about Snipe to kill patrons?
Snipe is really great. I love the card.
Dude, that card is sick. Me and Lothar built the Dragon Hunter, deck.
Kind of like that.
And we were just, our whole entire goal was just to line up Snipe perfectly for patrons, and we got it a few times in a row on ladder. It was awesome. And we climbed to like rank 300 legends or something like that.
I was using like
kill the Warsong, just stop them in their tracks.
They obviously make it a turn 5 play with Patron and
with the Deathbite. And
it was so obvious the way it was set up. So we're like, okay, play Snipe, even though it's off curve right now. Like 5 mana, play Snipe, doesn't matter.
True. I was using Snipe during the first IEM finals.
Oh, yeah, that's right, when you played against Artosis and he defeated you with, was it?
Three times with Warrior, three
was
times
it the
turn 8.
The crazy brawl?
Yeah, the crazy brawl, and three times. A Grommash with Inner Rage donate. It was funny. Funny time, sir. But yeah, let's go back into the game. Death Spite on turn 3 seems like a good option.
Right. I mean, that's pretty much the key to unlocking this entire matchup is weapons, because the weapons help you stabilize and you don't have to be super reliant on, like, well, I play Acolyte on turn 3 and hope he doesn't have a bow type of play.
Yeah, the problem here is the fact that you have to use Death Spite again on turn 4. So it's not being open to patrons on turn 5, right?
But
right.
There's a lot of the combo on his hand here, but still has to wait a while to use it.
That's actually a really great hand. Maybe he actually can spare the attack this turn when he plays Shield Block, Shield Slam on the Pelted Shredder, right?
He still takes like 3 damage from the scientist Webster, and then like there's might be like a big minion that comes out of the shredder, so like you still take a lot of damage, and like you need to stabilize your life total first before I think you can think of combos. Like,
so
yeah, we have like a deck with the shield block shield sam to like be a little bit more comfortable with the life totals. Yeah, he right here like he doesn't have a clear cut play device. Like
everything is awkward anyway. But what about just throwing Berserker? You know that might be a freezing trap because you saw the web spinner, right? So. That kind of changes your way of thinking about the matchup too.
I would like to call him here, but he decided to check first what comes out of the portal.
It could have been the mana rest.
It would be fine because he has 4 mana and he's not going to play anything else this turn.
Well, he could have played the Whirlwind. If that would be like a one-eyed cheat, right? An example. The Whirlwind would be really great.
Or there's a lot of minions with one health. Oh,
that's a great one here.
Yeah, that's a pretty sick one.
This
to trade.
Is really great.
Makes the trade really easy here with the
Okay.
But you can go face. 7 damage.
Yeah, that is a reasonable amount of damage still. Would you want to take care of this frog thing at all? Do you acknowledge it or do you use his hero power?
Well, since like every removal of the warrior like contains like some kind of AoE, just like the whirlwind, deathbite effect, whatever.
Right.
It's gonna kill off the scientist, so you're gonna get the freezing trap most likely. So kind of deal with the frothing before taking too much damage. But yeah, he's thinking about like just playing creeper or hero power here. I think. I'm pretty sure he's gonna trade. No.
Seems to he goes super aggressive. I like it. I like it, but he doesn't know that there's a shield block, shield slam combo.
He's gonna be
ahead.
Punished by this. Yeah. Kind of. Like, a little bit.
No, it definitely will. But the question is, does it matter if he gets punished slightly for it? Because if you shield block, shield slam, you have 1 more mana. I mean, are you going to take care of the scientist? Then you're still only at 12 HP.
Second shield slam.
That's really good, actually. You can double shield slam here.
Yeah, and you leave the mad scientist out, right?
You can actually kill it. Like, you don't have to leave it alive. You don't want to take damage really here. You can also just like hit the goblin auto lover here with the throbbing. Makes him kind of weak to be like just the scientist hit. But if you just you can put all his eggs in one basket here with the throbbing if he goes double shield slam.
Yeah, he goes late.
Just poisons him to trade into like the throbbing. Kind of makes sense. Both of us are pretty good throw here though.
Is it? Well, yeah. He can be...
It's 5 more damage guaranteed, pretty much. So, and he's already down to 12, so... Pretty sure he's going to trade the scientist into the prodding here to get the freezing trap. No? So he keeps contradicting me and just going crazy.
Well, I mean, I think the key is that he wants to squeeze in damage as much as he can. Like, if you give Patron time to set up a combo, then it doesn't matter if they're at, like, 4 HP. If you don't have the killing damage, you can't win, because they'll be able to put you on a 2-turn clock. Yeah.
Well... This turn is interesting. Like, you can, an example, play Whirlwind after you attack with Rolling Berserker, right? Because then you avoid the freezing trap, so you can clear the board, but you lose the whole turn for the Whirlwind, right?
Yeah. That's
then you have, you know, there will be a freezing trap out, so you have to set up something to trigger it. An example, next turn, maybe you will drop like an patron, just then that's it. And like, you know, multiply it with your draws next turn.
Found an interesting Core Hound here, but like, D2 has no answer, but the Hymen is just better because it doesn't matter.
Yeah, Core Hound on Curve would be so much sweeter. It's an even golden
one. I mean, if he had like some kind of finisher, like you could save that kind of stuff. Like the Core Hound doesn't really do anything. Usually, like, it just dies to Big Game Hunter.
Yeah, it's the same amount of damage, pretty much, too. Like, it's just
one
more and it's more, like, vulnerable to execute than the Hymen is.
I mean, sometimes Kill Command is, like, this whole point where you try to use a beast, but Core Hound's even more clunky to the point where you can't Kill Command and Hero Power. That's what you want to do late game.
Luckily for DTwo, he picked up the weapon here.
He's 1 damage up.
Yeah, he's really close.
No, he has lethal with the...
Oh, Unleash the Hound is 1 damage.
Yeah. Let's see if he sees it. He's kind of slow here.
Yeah, it's just making sure it plays automatically. Yeah. Alright, so that's going to wrap it up here. The pressure was too much, but this is kind of what Hunter's supposed to do. Warrior did get the weapon early, but ultimately when Hunter curves, generally speaking, pretty well. I mean, the only misstep was Lotheb instead of High Main, but it's still a really big threat.
Yeah, he didn't get it early enough. Like, he had the knife juggler, he got an attack, got a couple of juggles of it, and like that was enough to just like put enough pressure on the Patron Warrior make him like do like really uncomfortable plays.
Right. And at the same time, you know, Warrior had to take a lot of damage. It, like you were suggesting, Lothar, maybe in retrospect, he should have been more defensive about his health total. Shield slamming the Pilot Shredder instead of like taking the damage and then shield slamming whatever comes out of it.
Well, he would have taken the damage anyway, but he would have been saving the Death Spite for Patron, and the Patron might have been saving him a lot of life life total.
Exactly.
And overall, like, switch the dynamic of the match with the patrons here, because they were like a dead card for the whole match.
Yeah. I mean, it's quite brutal. Druid has Wild Growth times two, but the second Wild Growth not as useful, because...
Looks like it's going to be a turn four Wild Growth. Like yeah, shade into like Wild Growth, which is totally fine.
Yeah.
Like, D2 is going to be really sad. Like, even though, like, Commander's pretty good here, though. Like,
double seven Hymen is something that you want to get against Druid, though.
Yeah.
Interesting.
It's going to be a turn four Keeper now.
Yeah, I mean, this Wild Growth might sit there for a long time.
It can, but also, like, turn 10 it all depends on what he will draw. Like, upcoming turns.
Like, D2, like, just gets everything off the top here, which is really different.
Hopper
is kind of weak here, though. Like, it just dies to the Keeper, unfortunately.
That's true, and there is no... like clean play on turn five, and maybe Druid can climb back on board though, if that's the case.
Like he's like the Druid is way ahead here, like way ahead.
Do you want to trade off this juggler? I feel tempted to.
No, I don't think you do. The Keeper has a favorable trade here, and even if he like gets the juggler on the Keeper and gets the trade with the knife juggler, it's still better keeping like the 4/4 shade next turn around.
But what are you gonna use it for eventually? I mean,
just push through a Belcher, just
okay.
Push for damage. It's like always a big threat. That's fine too. Like just like it's both fine.
I feel like it's
this
idealistic.
This is a little bit slower. Like keeping the shade around gives him more tempo on a future turn, but because he can get a really big swing with it.
But most of the time, you lose to a hunter because you didn't save your life totals. Like
right.
In general, not only with Druid, but with Druid, you only have two ways to like improve your life totals in general, which are two Ancient of Lore, which are like craving. Druid is just craving for cards, so using Ancient of Lore for healing is kind of like something you didn't want to do at all. Hunter's Mag, though, zero mana, four damage.
Yeah, that tempo
that's pretty damn good.
Sylvanas needs to be the saving grace for the Druid here. Even though he had a really great start, he's behind in tempo, and like the freezing type that's gonna come off this scientist, like it's just gonna like most likely D2 is gonna trade. So Sylvanas
really
gets freezing trap.
Yeah, but Sylvanas here seems like a good option, but there's the mad scientist as you said. So the freezing trap will just make the Sylvanas turn miserable.
Well, you do have Force of Nature.
Oh, you do have Force.
The Force of Nature allows you to pick off the Freezing Trap and be able to dictate a better trade overall.
True, but then you sacrifice your win condition here, because you're at 21, you will get 6 points of damage. Like,
you gotta play a Hymen here, right?
Yeah, right. Well, wait. Then you have to clear Keeper, kill the...
I think it depends on what comes out of the Shredder, to be honest.
Yeah, that's true.
The thing is, like, it's really weird. You want to have the freezing trap here, but at the same time, you don't want to like the Sylvanas. Don't want the Sylvanas damage, so it can get Wrath and just steal a high main, which would be really, really unfortunate. So, Belcher might be a better option here. I'm not sure.
He would probably want to play the minion first.
I don't know if like it's worth it.
That's not too bad of a card. Sometimes Druid really needs to leverage spells, but
like Wild Growth double into it's double spell.
Yeah, but
you know what I mean though. Guys, like if he swipes, he needs to be careful mind that.
Like if he trades this here and goes for the Sylvanas play, he's gonna lose his Hymen to the Force of Nature because Sylvanas gonna be on 3 HP. A tree is gonna proc the freezing trap and then the proc is a 3/3, so Sylvanas can just steal the Hymen.
That's a really bad drop. Yeah, you're right. Totally right.
Oh my goodness, you are correct, sir.
So let's see if Fisher sees it, but I'm pretty sure that like, he's an experienced player, so he's gonna.
Yeah,
he sees that
instantly. Well, it was the plan anyway to use the Force of Nature for freezing trap, right?
That's what I said. Like, look first what comes out of the Shredder. If it's a 3 attack minion, Sylvanas is gonna steal a Hymen.
Oh, man.
Let's hope it's, oh, if it's now explosive
DTwo
trap,
realizes
I guess
going
it's
on.
The same thing if it's explosive trap.
Yeah, if it's explosive trap, you could have activated either way.
Oh, now he's sad.
Oh,
set ice.
All right.
Set
well,
ice.
I mean, Hunter also has a hard time dealing with its own high main problems, by the way.
Well, he has Belcher, right?
You know, one of the things, what's so ironic about Hunter is that sometimes the best counter to Hunter cards are Hunter cards. Mm-hmm. Like Unleash the Hounds against Freezing or Flare against Traps.
Yeah.
But in this case, Hunter actually can't deal with high main either that easily.
It's going to be a smorg fest
and
here
it's
on both sides.
Super bad the situation for Hunter player here when he knows that one of the treants was used for the freezing trap and he can be reused
for
the second
freezing
trap.
Exactly.
It's awful.
So it's basically useless. Like the other freezing is pretty useless. You don't want to draw it. But like here, it's not that bad of a spot for DTwo since the Fisher doesn't have a clear answer for the high main. He still has to be a little bit worried about his life total. Like DTwo is probably going to think about combo from like turn 9 on, but we see that Fisher doesn't have it in his hand right now, and he actually has a pretty hard time dealing with the Hyman here.
Well, he can trade, then kill one of the Hyenas with the Wrath and just play Druid of the Claw. Or maybe even just play Azure Drake and draw and kill the one of the Hyenas and just leave one open.
Yeah,
that's also an option because you will be ahead of board on the board anyway.
Like if he plays the Claw, I would like to see them trade and like play the Wrath here. I don't want them to like give him the value trade with a 6-5 into the 6-1.
What about just to go face here?
Why would you Wild Growth there?
Wild Growth?
Wild Growth gives you 10 mana next turn.
So that's
does
like
it make a difference?
It's like a Drake Wrath and the tree.
Yeah, the Drake Wrath and the tree. So he's anticipating that this 6-5 will kill off the 4-6.
Yeah.
And then he can use the Wrath and then Drake and tree and clean up.
Let me go for the the Ultra Bell, which I like better than the Houndmaster because it's pretty easy to clear off the 8-3 hyena. Like it's better to like just drop it under one of the hyenas it's going to drop out, just like get a 4-4 taunt.
Jeez, okay. Savage Roar. Unfortunately, he just used the Druid of the Claw, but that Treant can also be used for a combo.
Yeah.
See what he picks up off this Wrath.
Dr. Boom, well, that's quite a good drop, I would say.
That's pretty insane considering that he needs to fight back for the state of the board.
Yeah.
His opponent will have.
And he has already the Savage Roar.
You're
so
right.
If the Hunter leaves open the Boom Bots, those can hit, you know.
Or if Savannah High Main dies, there's 2/2s left remaining.
Yeah.
He has to be a little bit worried was left a little heal.
But there's only one card in the Hunter's hand.
There's 10 damage showing, though, and it's kind of hard.
And there's the second Freezing Trap.
Doable. Eight
which is
damage.
Horrible in this situation.
Yeah, exactly. It's pretty terrible. I think it's going to be a game for the duty. Like,
Wait. Hulk. If he kills the Boom Bots,
I think he can stay alive for one more turn, but I don't think he can win.
He has to go face with
everything. It's got to be like quick shot outs at this point, right?
He's gonna set up the Freezing Trap here. Like he's going to trade 2-1-1 or the 1-2 into the
bot. Okay.
That's kind of ideal, in fact.
But he's gonna
this will kill the Haina. No. That was close.
No, it's not a golden Dr. Boom. That's
I forgot about that. Yeah,
that was DeFishou's first misplay, not getting the golden.
So force is lethal, is pretty obvious. Let's see if that's lethal. Let's see
the Treant bounces back and you Savage Roar.
No, it's not lethal. No.
Well, you have 2 taunts in the way, so.
Yeah, you can hit one with your face, the other one and cast to get hit by him.
Yeah.
Actually, you can double tree. You can try to play the tree twice, and that's lethal, actually. He plays against Savage Roar.
Oh, that's pretty sick lethal.
If he sees it.
Like that's he should be
that's
able to.
7 plus 9. No, he's one. No, he's no. 7 plus 9 is.
That's 13 16. Plus 4,
it's
that's 17.
See, no, he's 2 up. He needs to clear one with his face.
No, well, he clears one of his face, the second one with
17. Sorry.
Yeah, it's one of lethal.
Right.
You still can go for it, though.
Right. He could.
Probably not. He wants to clear and just kill him next turn because there's no way that. Unless it's a quick shot into Leroy Jenkins.
Yeah.
To kill him next turn, right?
Yeah, exactly, because he had like 9 showing with like 12 HP.
Exactly.
It was quick shot out time. That's basically what he's been relegated to.
So he needs a Doomsayer here.
And
pretty much.
Yeah, Doomsayer is his last hope.
DTwo's not gonna go for it.
He will trade the Hounds in this situation, because if it's Doomguard, your Hounds are not usable anyway.
But you need
right?
to trade the High Man. You need to trade the High Man with one of the 1-1s, and then go for the Doomsayer.
Do you, but then you can win next turn.
Yeah, so he's going for like the safer play because then he can get damage
he's
off
still
top.
Still one off, and that's lethal. No, 10, yep. 16, 17. We're still one off without the keeper.
Yeah, the keeper pushes it over the top, and that means TheFishou takes the series 3-0. It's been very quick. I guess we wrap up the series very fast, but TheFishou's looking in prime shape. I like the pacing. I really like some of his plays, too. He's able to spot some of the good ones, like the Savannah Steel on the high
yeah,
main.
Yeah, that was a really great
Druid
play.
Players all over the world just fist pumped yeah, Injustice, because that is the most problematic card for yeah. Druid to deal with. Like that high main alone is such a headache.
Yeah.
And that, like, yeah. You know, Hunter's used to just power the way through the matchups.
And usually Sylvanas isn't even that good against high main because he, like, might as well just, like, get a 2-2 and that's,
exactly.
Like, still fine. So.
Oh, he got frozen.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's basically it. And Sylvanas right. for 8 mana.
It's often stuck in your hand for so yeah. long. Even if you have Druid the Claw and you bounce it back, you still lose a lot of tempo. And
yeah,
then
exactly.
They have, like, some small minions. You steal, like, a web spinner and you question your life. You punch your hand through the monitor. Your hand's bleeding. You're out, like, $300 because you paid a 60 hertz monitor for some reason.
I see that after the power nap, your humor is like up.
It's
also.
Crazy, man. It's really difficult, but he made it.
Have a
and,
seat.
So TheFishou is joined with us on the desk, who's currently... What's your record right now?
I think
excuse
it's
me,
no,
but,
right?
But my English is a big joke.
One,
but
well, it's okay. We'll manage. So that was your third match for the day. What's your score? It's 3-0?
No. 3-0, yes.
Oh, nice.
No,
nice.
Sure. Didn't you lose to Chalky?
Yes, 3-2.
So you're 2-1 right now, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, he thought this stuff. We're talking
oh,
about
yeah,
games.
Okay. Yeah,
games.
That's true.
So why no Warrior in your lineup? Because everyone says Warrior is really good.
Because I would like to counter and lock mm-hmm. with the
lineup.
Tournament with great player.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Like they too. So I take.
So if you play Patron,
Ant midrange, mm-hmm. Druid. And I think and luck to counter and luck.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Fair yeah. enough.
Okay.
I mean, if you expect a lot of good players, Handlock is a deck that people will bring because they feel really confident. Just look at Life Coach, for example. He always he always plays Handlock. He never plays Zoo. So if you expect a really strong field of players who are confident, I think it's a reasonable pick. Yeah,
that's
for sure.
That's true.
Yeah.
So congratulations. Again.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You will be fighting for top 8 tomorrow, 4 matches ahead of you, right? You have to win 4 of them,
yeah.
right?
So I think it's possible, yeah.
Of course it's possible, yeah. yeah. And how are you feeling about your lineup? Do you think it's okay with the current environment
yeah,
here?
I think it's I'm good with my lineup and I've very tryhard for this tournament, so I'm confident. Good.
How do you think the French community stacks against the rest of the world? A lot of people don't know too much about France and Hearthstone because you guys,
yeah.
you do your own thing sometimes.
Yeah, we have very good player in France.
Yeah.
Like you need Loelo mm-hmm. and Maverick.
And how are they doing? Are they doing well in the tournament too?
Do you know what is their score?
You need it 3-0 and the other 2-1.
Okay,
so
wow. Pretty strong overall so far. So they're all
all French players are day 2.
Okay, right on. Farmer, do you have any questions for the future? It's been a long day, so we don't want to take too much of his time.
Yeah, not really. Like, did you, like, at any point, like, think about just coming to this tournament, like, countering Patron Warrior or countering Warrior at all as a strategy? Or did you always want to go for, like, countering Handlock?
I don't understand.
did you think about playing against patrons? Did you want to counter patrons at all, or did you just think about the Handlock?
Patron is not a deck who afraid me, so
oh,
okay.
Wow. So you're not afraid at all.
I think it's not very. It's good, but not like Handlock or Druid.
Okay.
Wow. So that's interesting to see that he doesn't really consider Patron War to be better than Druid and Handlock.
That's
the
first time I
actually heard that in a long yeah. time. It's cool. It's kind of like a month ago when people didn't really care about Patron War that much. Well, yeah. Congratulations. Really
Thank
cool
you.
Interview. Great perspective from a bench player, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Yes.
In the meantime, guys, we'll just wrap up the day here. Farmer, I hope you don't mind sticking around just till we close the show here.
Of course.
So let's go ahead and talk about everything that we saw today. We had 3 rounds of Swiss where, at the end of the day, we have a group of players who are undefeated, some who are 2-1, some who are 1-2, and unfortunately some 0-3 people. But
yep.
we do have a good amount of players who also just called it quits midway through. They said, you know what, I'm 0-2, I'm not going to play the rest of this event. Some players did end up panning out. For example, Vortex and Hyped, two players who are pretty strong, did end up playing each other, and Hyped won that series 3-2, and so he's redeeming himself. I guess his goal is to go 5-2 instead of 0-7, so to speak.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. And we've had some really crazy matches, too. I think my personal highlight day was Dog versus Nyria, the crazy Lorewalker Cho games. Did you get to see that at all, Farmir?
No, unfortunately, I played my game while that was going
on.
It was pretty crazy, like a Cho on only spells on both hands.
Yeah, Warrior had like three preps in his hand for some reason, and like he sapped twice.
Nice.
It was so funny. It was ridiculous.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's one of the strategies, just to fill your opponent's hand with useless cards. And
right. No, I totally meant it. Because Dog came in, he's like, how am I supposed to play this deck? I think I misplayed like 4 or 5 turns in a row. I was like, well, you have to ask your teammate Noxious, who's probably used to this kind of silly shenanigans. That was probably the my favorite moment for me. Tomorrow, guys, we're going to continue this pretty much the same exact thing. We have to finish 7 rounds of Swiss, because at the end of it, one player will be undefeated and 7 players will be 6-1. We take those top 8 players, we put them in day number 3 to play single elimination bracket, which you guys are used to, and we're going to broadcast all of those. Tomorrow, we're definitely going to reevaluate how we also do the broadcast. We recognize there was a lot of downtime, but we started fixing it throughout the entire day. Hope you guys appreciated that. And make sure to tune in tomorrow starting at 10:30 a.m. Central European time. That's in about 23 hours from now, because it's 11:30 right now if you look at your screen. So in about 11 hours.
Yeah,
23
like
hours
confused.
From now, we'll be wrapping up the day. just making sure you guys were paying attention.
Yeah.
Good job. You're still awake. All right. So round 4 will begin 10:30. Any final words from you guys before we head off?
No, I hope I'm the only one left from our team, so I hope I do well tomorrow, but we'll see.
You're the only one?
Yeah, oh. Powder and DTwo both lost 1-2, unfortunately.
Well, for Nihilum, is only ties from the start. Yeah. So,
still in. I think Kongen is still in.
He was playing.
He
was 2-1 up when I checked and was like ahead in the last game, so I'm pretty sure he made it.
Yeah, he won his Series 3-1, I believe. All so right.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So great news.
I mean, that's kind of like the story of Kongen, right? Everyone underestimates him until he just like does pretty well sometimes, and even contends for like the spot where people are like, what? Really? You got like top 16 or top 8?
Didn't sleep for 40 hours now.
Yeah. He actually was going to take a nap and kind of miss his first match, but he realized he had to play, so he just showed up. He's like, all right, I'm ready to go.
And let's do it.
Ends up doing as well as most of the majority of the players. So well done. Well done. Well, that's it from us. Thanks so much for tuning in to day 1. Make sure to hashtag DHS15 to let everyone know your thoughts as well as some of your favorite moments on social media. Until then, have a good night, and we'll see you guys tomorrow.
This is Hearthstone.